Howdy, folks. What's going on? I'm back in my Focus. I'm pretty sure I put up a video about that already. But it's happy. It's getting good fuel mileage, which makes me ecstatic because that's the whole reason I bought the car. I bought it because it was the, outside of hybrids, what I got, it is like in the top two vehicles that Ford has made for miles per gallon in the past 10-15 years. So there might be one that gets a little better on highway driving, but interstate, this one probably takes the cake from it because it's got a different transmission. Anyway, that is not what I want to talk about today. I got sent on a Christmas shopping list by my wife, for my wife. She told me what she wanted. I was heading to go try and get it. I couldn't get it done, but I ended up at a local firearms dealer, and this place is always hopping. So they've got one of those pull a number, wait till we call your number kind of deals. And while I'm waiting, I'm just kind of meandering around, browsing things, and just, you know, kind of a guy in my element, so to speak. So I'm just, you know, looking around, seeing what's on the shelves and available, which, it's funny, due to COVID and riots and lockdowns and unrest, record firearm sales to first time buyers, record ammo sales. I wish I had stock in any firearms company, especially those that did both firearms and ammunition, because I would have been handsomely rewarded for my stake in those shares. All that said, I seen one thing on the shelf, a box of ammo for sale for nothing that I've got. I don't have pockets deep enough to shoot these kind of weapons. For a Barrett 416. And I've got to tell you the story about how that gun came to be. To do that, I've got to go way on back in Army history. They contracted with a company, I believe it was Browning, to make a automatic weapon capable of, and I don't remember what all it was even capable of, what all the criteria was, but they had, you know, put out feelers on this weapon, and they wanted something built that would destroy light armor, aircraft, land vehicles, could penetrate through fortified enemy encampments, things like that. The 50 caliber is born. It's been in the service for, I want to say it came in at the end of World War I. Don't hold me to that. I know it was in popular service in World War II. My granddad worked with them in the 443rd anti-aircraft. They were the anti-aircraft guns on naval vessels. They went into the U.S. Army Air Force in a lot of their wing guns and such. They were the weapon of choice on bombers. They were a heavy machine gun emplacement in the Army for bases and such. Very versatile, very reliable weapon that packed a tremendous punch and was fairly accurate. Fast forward, companies built civilian grade weapons around that bullet. And when I say civilian grade, all I mean is non-fully automatic weapons. So bolt action or semi-automatic, where you squeeze the trigger once, one bullet goes down range, you release the trigger, you shoot again, another bullet goes down range. The ones that were in the Army were mostly either bolt action sniper rifles, which are kind of rare, or fully automatic weapons where you squeeze the trigger and you hold and it will keep shooting till you release the trigger or it runs out of ammunition. Well, anyway, California, a number of years ago, is responsible for a weapon that's better than the 50 cal. They decided that you could not have a weapon over projectile diameter. Well, the 50 caliber is like 0.504 something. It's down there in the fractions of an inch. But the reason is so that the bullet will catch in the riflings of the barrel quite well and cause it to rotate to increase its accuracy. Well, I believe it was Barrett, decided, okay, we'll play that game. So bullets are measured in the amount of material that you're sending downrange is measured in something called grains. I don't know the conversion to ounces or grams. If someone knows that, feel free to put it in the comments below. I know a little bit about a wide variety of topics when it comes to firearms. That's one that I don't remember the conversion on off the top of my head. They took the same number of grains, or the same amount of grain in lead, and stretched it so that you had a longer, narrower projectile to 4/16 of an inch. No, 416/1000 of an inch. Pardon me. That's the precise measurement. Whereas a 50 caliber is just half an inch. So you had a longer projectile, less frontal area, same weight, better aerodynamics. So California, when they banned the 50 cal, Barrett decided, you know what, we want to still be able to shoot, you know, big game bolt action rifles out there. So they made the Barrett 416. It's the exact same weight in the projectile. They use the same brass, the rear part of it. They just neck it down to fit the 416, which when a 50 cal goes off, the powder ignites and goes forward, hits the back of the bullet, breaks a seal in the or breaks it loose from the brass, and the lead starts flying forward. Well, there's one thing about a 416 that actually helps increase performance. When you neck it down, the powder has to generate higher pressure by going faster to travel through that step down and neck. Think of it like when you step in your basement, you look up at your plumbing. If you were to reverse all that and have, okay, so the water that comes in from the water main, you know, big pipe like so, or pipe like this. If it steps down into a pipe like this, to get the same volume of water through, it's got to move faster and at greater pressure. Same basic principle in gunpowder. Well, so with the 416 Barrett, you have a bullet that travels faster, straighter, has better coefficient of drag, less drop per 100 yards, puts as much, if not more, foot-pounds of energy on target at a given distance, compared to a 50 cal. And the only difference between the two guns as far as California is concerned is that one's legal, one's illegal. And they made a better, flatter shooting gun that's more legal in California. So whenever people start yapping about how good government is at doing things, that's one of the stories. And I don't know if it's 100% true or not. I would like to research that. My brother-in-law, who used to be in the Army Rangers, told me about that. So I would think he would know a couple things about very high-powered, very expensive weapons. But that's just something I always thought was pretty hilarious, that they tried to ban one of the most lethal weapons in California, which, in fairness, they did. But they ended up causing a firearm company to make a better one, just so they could sell it in California. Now, to my knowledge, the 416 Barrett hasn't seen wide adoption in any use of the armed force, or in any branch of the armed forces, because it's not as common as a 50 cal. A 50 cal is more universal, because you can get a 50 caliber weapon for long range shooting. You can get a 50 caliber weapon set up for more aggressive shooting, where you're putting out, you know, rounds per minute instead of a highly accurate round right on target. So I don't think that the Barrett 416 has seen wide adoption by the armed forces, but they did definitely make, Barrett definitely did make a better weapon in the 416 than they did the 50 cal. Don't get me wrong, I'd take either one. Probably take the 50 cal just because rounds are more plentiful. But, and also I imagine parts would be a little more common. But I just thought it was interesting that they had, how that backfired on them, so to speak. Anyway, that's all I got for today, folks. Thanks for tuning in. Catch y'all next time. Hope you had a good Thanksgiving.